operates. Good afternoon, judges. My name is Justice, and today my partner and I will be upholding the con side of today's debate. That committing United States ground combat troops to fight ISIL is not in the best interest of the United States. Mainstream media and news outlets have oversimplified America's fight against ISIL. The matter of engaging ISIL goes far beyond counterterrorism and is muddled with a deep underlying history of regional conflict that comes with costly consequences should the United States blindly underestimate the issue. While ISIL's activities demonstrate how violent it is, the organization ultimately does not pose a direct threat to the U.S. and its interests. For further clarification, ISIL is defined as the Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant, also commonly referred to as ISIS, the Islamic State of Iraq and al-Sham. To support our negation of the resolution, we offer two key reasons. One, the ISIL threat to the U.S. will not be solved by United States ground troops, and two, committing U.S. ground troops will exacerbate conflict. Contention one, the ISIL threat will not be solved by U.S. ground troops. While high-profile attempts at terrorist attacks have flooded the news, many fail to explain that these attempts are never actually conducted by ISIL members. If anything, the threat comes from self-proclaimed ISIL sympathizers and supporters, individuals who have been exposed to the state's viral presence. Furthermore, the existential threat to the United States has been over-exaggerated to the public. Adam Johnson, writing for Fairness and Accuracy in Reporting, notes that, quote, much of the ISIS threat, namely that which targets the West, has been habitually overstated by an uncritical media, end quote. He continues to include corporate media falsities and hyperbole, ranging from accounts of a $425 million bank heist to genital mutilation of Westerns. Each of the 10 different stories listed in this article are reported by corporate media were later proved false or based on incomplete evidence or unreliable sources. If anything, the threat ISIL poses to the U.S. is that of its effective use of manipulating the general public into a state of fear, and thereby preys off the nation's vulnerability in order to arouse a call for military response. By sending in ground troops, the U.S. would be engaging in an unnecessary war that will ultimately lead to long-term consequences that vastly outweigh any potential gains. Contention 2. U.S. ground troops will exacerbate conflict. Subpoint A. U.S. anti-ISIL intervention has already led to increased violence. ISIL primarily focused its attention on its regional ambitions prior to the U.S.-led airstrike campaign. But as the U.S. and others continue to bombard ISIL targets, the group has repeatedly retaliated in the form of advertising the executions of Westerns on a public scale. As demonstrated in America's prior military involvement in the Middle East, sending in U.S. ground troops will result in a long, drawn-out war that the U.S. is currently in no position to pursue. Regardless of polls demonstrating public support, by lacking in any proper strategy that addresses the fact that this is not a matter of counterterrorism or counterinsurgency, the U.S. falls vulnerable to losing more lives. Subpoint B, intervention in sectarian conflict has drastic political consequences. As Doug Bando states in a Forbes article, quote, intervention brings unintended, unpredictable, and uncontrollable consequences. Joining such conflict in such a region is inherently challenging, end quote. By ignoring the fact of the matter that of combating ISIL comes along with long-standing sectarian conflict, the U.S. will be replacing a set of problems with another set of a greater magnitude. The expected ground operation on Mosul proposed by General John Allen is seen to be more dangerous due to the presence of four different armed militias in the province. Between the Kurdish Peshmerga forces, the Yazidi militia, a local Christian militia, and the People's Militia, all of this military mobilization will result in a contested battlefield in which each party is fighting for their own goals. With U.S. interference, the nation will be entering a fray that goes far beyond a battlefield. By combating ISIL, an organization with its priorities pertaining to regional insurgency, it's necessary that the conflict remain on a regional scale with as little U.S. interference as possible. In conclusion, not only does ISIL fail to pose a direct threat that justifies committing U.S. ground combat troops, but also by doing so will result in repercussions that outweigh any potential gains that my partner and I can only ask for your strongest negation in today's debate. Thank you.
Ms. Lauren, I'll be your first affirmative speaker in today's debate, arguing resolved. Committing U.S. ground combat troops to fight ISIL is in the best interest of the United States. ISIL refers to the Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant, an Islamic extremist group that controls land in Iraq and Syria. The affirmative team may also refer to ISIL by its alternative names, ISIS and the Islamic State. We affirm today's resolution for two main reasons. One, defeating ISIS is in the best interest of the United States. And two, the United States must commit ground combat troops in order to defeat ISIS. Contention one, defeating ISIS is in the best interest of the United States. Subpoint A, ISIS threatens domestic security. The UN reports that ISIS has committed crimes against humanity, including forced amputation, sexual enslavement, and genocide. Foreigners within the region, including those at US embassies and bases, are especially vulnerable to ISIS's brutality. The terror group has already beheaded American hostages, burned a Jordanian pilot alive, and posted videos of their executions online. The threat of violent jihadism is not confined to the Middle East. ISIS has a broad appeal to foreign radicals. CBS reports that over 20,000 fighters, including 100 to 300 Americans, have gone off to fight with ISIS. Foreign fighters and others radicalized by the Islamic State pose serious security risks. Two successful terrorist attacks took place in France last year by ISIS members. Furthermore, the Islamic State has also called for attacks on American soil. The group has already published a hit list of over 300 United States service members and inspired several domestic terror attempts. The FBI Assistant Director has since declared ISIS to be the most severe threat to the United States since 9/11. Subpoint B, the growth of ISIS threatens United States interests. ISIS has expanded its reach from Syria and Iraq to that of Yemen, Pakistan, and Libya. If ISIS continues to grow, CNN warns that the Islamic State will spread to other Middle Eastern countries, namely Tanzania, Jordan, and Egypt. The growth of the Islamic State compromises Americans' influence in the region, threatens US allies, and creates safe havens for terrorist activities. ISIS's recent success has led to 31 terror organizations in 15 countries, including that of Nigeria, India, and the Philippines, to declare their allegiance to the Islamic State. ISIS now makes over $3 million a day and uses this money to fund and train its affiliate groups, who then adopt and emulate this anti-American ideology. The US Department of State has issued a warning to all Americans in the Middle East, Africa, Europe, and Asia that due to growing influence of ISIS, travelers are at a high risk for terrorist violence while abroad. Furthermore, Iran has also been taking advantage of the locational instability to strengthen its ties with Iraq by offering military assistance. If the United States fails to act, Iran, the largest state sponsor of terrorist activity and an advocate for nuclear proliferation, will increase its regional influence. Contention 2, the United States must commit ground combat troops in order to defeat ISIS. America is currently leading the international air campaign against ISIS, relying on aerial surveillance methods to locate targets and place additional ground combat troops. However, as the LA Times reports, without boots on the ground, the CIA cannot accurately track terrorist movements and assess the results of these airstrikes. Due to these intelligence gaps, American airstrikes have hit empty buildings and have caused over 50 civilian casualties within the province of Anbar alone. According to the New York Times, casualties caused by drones foster fear within civilians and lead them to join terror groups. For air campaigns to be successful, special combat forces must be allowed to direct airstrikes and to then gather intelligence within the field. Additionally, as airstrikes continue, the UN warns that ISIS will integrate itself within civilian populations. Local troops within Syria and its neighboring countries are losing land to ISIS daily and need the foreign assistance to drive jihadist forces away from the cities. The Council of Foreign Relations explains that small amounts of American special forces embedded within local armies will provide the expertise necessary to engage in a successful ground campaign. Working alongside Western troops is also the most efficient way to strengthen the regional capability of these security forces. Without ground combat troops, the anti-ISIS campaign is unlikely to succeed, and the threat of extremism will continue to grow. It is for this reason I can only ask you for your strongest affirmative vote in today's debate. Thank you.
There have been threats against Western nations, correct?
Correct.
Have any of these threats been carried out?
These threats have been carried out. I think we talked about two terror attacks by ISIS conducted in specifically Paris. My partner can bring up two other evidence
that
American hostages being taken in.
Can we see the evidence of this France terror attack stating specifically that these terror attacks were planned and we knew that they were planned?
Okay, may I ask you a question?
Okay.
So you talk about in your first contention how the threat is not going to be solved by ISIS ground combat troops, correct?
That's correct.
And the threat was mostly from supporters of ISIS, not members of ISIS?
Supporters of ISIS as well as their use of social media.
So what's the difference between supporters of ISIS and members of ISIS?
You see, the difference between these two is that supporters of ISIS are buying into the ideas and the belief that ISIS has. Therefore, even if you do use ground troops to combat ISIS, even if you're able to destroy ISIS, you would do nothing to get rid of these ideals that ISIS has already put out.
Isn't it true that ISIS, because of its money and because of its success, has been able to fund affiliate groups who would then adopt the group's ideology?
I'd actually like see evidence about this. Regardless of that, no matter what happens to ISIS, there's always going to be anti-US sentiment within this region.
And furthermore,
we're
talking about...
Can I ask you a question, actually? So how many Americans have been killed by ISIS?
As of now, four Americans have been killed, but then we're talking about the threat of ISIS's growth is being bigger than the threat of ISIS continuing now.
Threat that we have now, does that mean that we need to send in ground troops and endanger the lives of Americans?
We're saying that it's going to be most effective to send ground combat troops in now. And when the threat is rather small, as opposed to sending in ground combat troops when ISIS is going to spread. May I ask you a question?
Okay.
So you talk about, what did you agree that heightened terror attacks parallel to ISIS's growth?
Are you saying that there have been, where are you saying that these heightened terror attacks are happening?
We're saying that these heightened terror attacks are happening within the Middle East, along with this, they're taking place within Western nations.
Okay, I'd like to see evidence saying that the amount of terror attacks in the Middle East is increasing, first off, and can you then restate your base question?
Actually, you may ask a question.
I'm going to ask a question?
Yeah.
Okay. So you stated that there are crimes that have been committed against regional actors within this region by ISIS, correct?
Correct.
So is it the United States' job to police the Middle East?
It's not the United States' job to police the Middle East. However, we're stating that it's the United States' job to really take care of its national interests. And as of now, the growth of ISIS is a direct threat to America's national
security.
So
you're saying that countries within this region are not able to protect their own citizens, is that correct?
We're stating that countries in this region are unable to. They do not have the military capabilities to really defend and deter ISIS.
Why then should
we? Therefore, the United States must go in and commit ground combat troops to promote the success of the anti-ISIS campaign, as we have been doing so in the past. May I ask you a question?
Okay.
So isn't it true that the United States is already leading the war against ISIS and is already committed to defeating ISIS in this war?
Actually, no. We believe that they're leading the U.S. Airstrike Coalition. However, that
so
does not...
So they're leading the war against ISIS, basically, right?
The component of this war is not only in the air. As you know, there are many regional actors.
Wouldn't you agree
ground.
that the main source of this campaign against ISIS right now is of the air
campaign? We agree that the
United States is leading the air campaign, therefore it is leading the war against ISIS.
We only agree that the United States is leading an air campaign, not saying that it is the primary...
So who is the primary actor, then? And who is the most... Who are these regional forces that have the capability of defeating ISIS? If the United States
actually,
cannot
we're out of time.
You see that evidence,
that's my question.
Though?
About
if not the United States, who?
Okay.
So regional forces taking care of
it.
Yeah. Did you say 30 seconds?
My name is Vicky. My first speech today, I'd like to repeat my opponent's case, and if time permits, go on to reevaluate my own. Now, my opponent's first contention, they talked about what is in the, that defeating ISIL is in the best interest of the United States. And they talked about a threat to domestic security, and they also mentioned the beheading of journalists, as well as the broader appeal ISIL has to foreign fighters. Now, we can see that, yes, defeating ISIL is an interest of the United States, but not one that warrants United States ground combat troops. Now, the thing is, ISIL is not focused on defeating the United States. It is not an existential threat to America. ISIL's primary goal is to establish their own caliphate. It is, and as an article, or as the former head of MI6 states, the West was not the primary target of the radical fundamentalism that created ISIS. Quote, the conflict was essentially one of Islam, end quote. Now, see, by allowing the United States ground combat troops to go back into the Middle East, it will only be fueling this narrative that ISIL has built up, that the United States is making a war against Islam. We can see this is not going to be beneficial in the interest of the United States. Furthermore, we have seen that As Foreign Affairs article puts, ISIS is not merely an American problem. The wars in Iraq and Syria involve not only regional players, but also major global actors such as Russia, Turkey, Iran, Saudi Arabia, and other Gulf states. Washington must stop behaving as if it can fix the region's problems with military force and instead resurrect its role as a diplomatic superpower. So instead, we should be focusing on an alternate method, because as we've seen before, when we went to Iraq, we were there for 9 years. We went with the intent to stop Al-Qaeda, but we're drawn into another long, drawn-out war. By committing United States ground combat troops again into Iraq, when we had recently just pulled them out, we can see this isn't going to be working in the best interest of the United States. We cannot expect a different outcome by using the same method. Now, in my opponent's second contention, they talked about how we must commit United States ground combat troops in order to defeat ISIS. And they said that we have been leading air campaigns, but without boots on the ground, we are not able to efficiently coordinate these campaigns. And we can see here that the United States already has 4,400 military personnel in the Middle East already working in the fight against ISIS. We can see that these individuals are there to train regional actors and oversee other military personnel not belonging to the United States. So the United States is involved in this campaign against ISIL, but not to the extent that, but it should not be pushed to an extent that allows for further intervention. We can see that it is not, as I said before, not a war for the United States to intervene on. And furthermore, the United States is not even wanted with their Western troops. As the King of Jordan states, once again, quote, this is not a Western fight, this is a fight inside of Islam. And furthermore, he wants international support and involvement, but not Western troops. So we can see here that United States Western troops are not wanted. Simply the support and involvement of America is appreciated, yes, but not United States ground troops. We've seen the repercussions of having an American occupation already in the Middle East. As I stated before, we cannot expect a different outcome with using the same method of military combat troops. And furthermore, and moving on to my own contention, we can see that having the ISIL threat is not going to be solved by United States ground combat troops. My opponents mentioned the influence that ISIL has, and we can see that this influence is not going to be solved by United States ground combat troops. It's going to be resolved through other means by combating the issue at the source, at the sectarian source where ISIL is thriving, because it thrives off of conflict. If we eliminate this source of conflict, we can see that this is going to be beneficial, and we have to solve this through another means, through diplomatic means, and one that fosters healthy relationships within the region. And our second contention, we talked about how the troops will exacerbate the conflict, that the intervention through our air campaigns has already led to an increase in violence. The United States, the beheadings of these journalists was a result in retaliation of our airstrikes. We can see here that ISIL already has demonstrated that and is against the United States intervention. And furthermore, that the sectarian conflict has political, drastic political consequences that will not be solved by ground combat troops. So in conclusion, not only does ISIL fail to pose a threat that justifies committing US ground combat troops, but also in doing so will result in repercussions that outweigh any potential and limited gains. I can only ask for your strongest negation in today's debate. Thank you.
Second affirmative speaker in today's debate, first refuting my opponent's claims and entire permits, going on to refer my own. My opponent's first contention talked about the fact that the ISIL threat was overstated. Firstly, I'd like to point out that my opponents contradicted themselves by blatantly stating in their last speech that it is in interest of the United States to defeat ISIS. Additionally, under this contention, they talked about ISIS's use of social media. Judges, to really examine how we can best defeat ISIS's use of social media, we have to look at why foreign terrorist groups are joining ISIS. Actually, according to an article published by CNN October 7th of last year, it states, ISIS is more exclusive and better financed than more of their moderate counterparts. They also have more of an impact on the battlefield, which makes them more attractive. We can really see that the best way to combat these troops acting on behalf of ISIS, these troops joining ISIS, is to show them that ISIS is not a successful terrorist organization, that actually acting in opposition to Western interests, targeting Western targets, is not successful will lead to repercussions. Additionally, under this contention, they talked about the fact that the threat of ISIS is overstated. But does what they're ignoring is that the United States is already leading a military campaign against ISIS. As a result, ISIS has already targeted the United States. Actually, as an article published in August 20th, 2014 by the Business Insider states, though the Islamic State did not at first seem bent on attacks on the West, a series of videos it recently released resembled footage that Al-Qaeda turned up while killing US soldiers during the US killing those soldiers. The video suggests that the Islamic State was gearing up for an existential holy war between the Caliphate and the Crusader America. Basically, Basically, what we can see is because the U.S. is already leading a military campaign against ISIS, ISIS is already targeting America. We can see that it's actually in the best interest to really eliminate the ISIS threat before they have the ability to gain the resources, to gain the foundation needed to have a really successful terrorist attack on Western soil. Additionally, I'd like to point out several instances where ISIS has threatened U.S. interests. Specifically, as an article from Reuters published yesterday states, a man in Kansas actually attempted to attack a military base in the name of ISIS. Additionally, we can see in Algeria where a group aligned with ISIS actually attacked and killed a Western hostage, meaning that ISIS is already a threat that will continue to grow if the U.S. does not intervene. Also, under their second contention, specifically their first subpoint, they stated that U.S. intervention will lead to increased conflict. First, I'd like to point out that the current U.S. airstrikes are not working, that ISIS has spread into Libya, into Yemen, into Pakistan, into Syria. What we can see is actually by not sending in the appropriate amount of military force, it's allowing conflict to spread throughout the Middle East. Additionally, I'd also like to point out that yes, the U.S. is already a target, and there are already retaliatory attacks. Again, the best way really to defeat these retaliatory attacks is to defeat ISIS. Additionally, I'd like to point out that the U.S. does have a succinct strategy to defeating ISIS. Specifically, as an article published in February 2015 by CNN states, the command structure of local forces has basically evaporated. Though they have good soldiers, they have no leadership. An article published last year by the Council of Foreign Relations states, if America were to go in, it would not be a ground campaign, a major ground offense, as in previous wars. It would actually be sending small amounts of troops to work with local forces and actually boost their capability, because local forces really don't have the command structure needed to operate successfully in the field. We can see that the U.S. does have a successful plan for defeating ISIS that would require really minimal commitment. Additionally, under their second subpoint under this contention, they stated there will be political consequences to sending in U.S. troops, specifically because they're already conflict with militias. However, what they're ignoring is the fact that the U.S. is not sending soldiers is leading to a reliance on Iranian-backed militias that are causing these sectarian conflicts. Specifically, as an article published February this year by MSNBC states, militias backed by Iran are carrying out abuses that have further alienated Sunnis and served as a recruiting tool for ISIS. We can see that by causing Iraq to be reliant on Iranian forces, it's leading to further sectarian violence. The evidence actually goes on to state that the United States does have the ability, does have the diplomatic means to really mitigate this sectarian conflict, specifically because a meeting of 22 Sunni groups has specifically issued a statement stating that they will only intervene, they will only act on behalf of the Iraqi government to fight ISIS if American troops go in, because they do trust Americans over local forces. The article goes on to state that having these Sunni tribes commit to the ground offense against the Islamic forces will also ensure that the Islamic forces will be defeated. It will also ensure that there will be better political relations and less sectarian violence down the road. We can see that there are ways for the U.S. to defeat ISIS requiring relatively minimal conflict, and this is absolutely necessary to protect domestic security. So it is for this reason I ask for your strongest affirmative vote in today's debate. In Syria, in a variety of countries in the Middle East, specifically because local forces aren't adequate, because local forces don't have the necessary command structure. So I have a question regarding the fact that you stated that local actors can be successful. So when have local actors actually ever been successful against ISIS?
Well, we mentioned the Kurdish Peshmerga and how they were able to effectively retaliate against ISIS.
In what way? How much land did they take from ISIS?
I believe it was 25%.
In one country or in the entirety of ISIS held territory?
I believe it's in the country of Syria.
So since Kurdish forces have started fighting ISIS, have we seen ISIS stop gaining land? Or is ISIS currently gaining land?
Well, we can see here that these local forces are capable of defeating ISIL, and therefore the United States is under no moral obligation
only
whatsoever.
You stated only in Iraq. Are there any other countries where local forces are adequate?
Well, I can bring up evidence and show you that later. Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Okay, so you talked about reliance to Iran.
Yes.
So why should the Middle East become more reliant on the United States?
who were stating that firstly, because these troops lack a command structure, they really lack the means to effectively deter ISIS. Actually, we can provide you evidence that states that sending in U.S. advisors to work with local troops in the field is actually the best way to boost the capability of local security forces to recommit themselves to
staying in the long term. Didn't we try to do the same thing when we were in Iraq as well?
Well, actually, I believe what happened in Iraq is after the U.S. pulled up, there were there were political actions taken by the government, which actually spurred conflict. But we can see that the current Iraqi government is actually not the same government. The current Iraqi government is more stable, and if we could provide them the security needed to hold and establish a state, we would see long-term success. Actually, I have a question about the campaign in Iraq. So basically, previous to U.S. intervention in Iraq, Al-Qaeda was having multiple terrorist attacks against U.S. embassies on U.S. soil. After U.S. intervention, have we seen any successful attack by Al-Qaeda on U.S. facilities anywhere?
I do not believe we have seen
some of them. So we that we are successful.
Well, ISIL is a splinter group from Al-Qaeda. They were spawned out of the occupation in the Middle East. We can see here that if we continue to use this same method, even though we may weaken ISIL to an extent, there will always be other groups with ideology that does not adhere to the United States' own. So therefore, this is only a short-term solution.
Are you stating that we should allow ISIS to expand to further sectarian bands to further instability?
No, we're saying that we should be using alternative methods.
For example, diplomacy. So is ISIS going to diplomatically compromise itself with the United States?
We're saying that we should establish healthier relations with with regional actors in the Middle East.
Okay, so how is this going to actually leave our time?
Thank you.
Can I
please
see the
judges, in my final speech today, I'll answer two questions. One, is ISIS a direct threat to the U.S.? And two, what effects ground troops would have? Now, let's look at what we know about ISIS in their fight against the West. We know that 4 Americans have been killed by ISIS, and that there have been threats against Western countries, however, none of which have been carried out. The only actual attack that my opponents brought up that was supposedly done by an ISIS member was actually not carried out by a member or a sympathizer. Rather, it was carried out by, quote, a French Burundian extremist. So what we can see is that the only attack my opponents brought up against Western nations, saying it was from an ISIS member, it actually wasn't. Now, although these 4 Americans have died in the Middle East, it doesn't mean that we need to risk the lives of thousands of U.S. soldiers. Our opponents said that we are already leading the offensive, so we might as well use ground troops as well. However, there's a large difference between us using airstrikes now and us starting to use ground troops. No matter how small of a force my opponents say would be needed to combat ISIS effectively, it still puts the lives of U.S. soldiers in harm's way. And now moving on to looking at the effects of what ground troops would have. Now, analyzing the last time we went into this region to solve conflicts such as this, we ended up drawing ourselves into a long war that resulted in the highest number of U.S. military casualties in years. Along with this, it actually led to the creation of ISIS, leading us to believe that by sending in ground troops to combat ISIS themselves, it can only lead to the creation of even more terrorist groups. Now, what we can also see is that ground troops would foster even more anti-U.S. sentiment within this region. Now, as we stated in our case, prior to the U.S.-led airstrike campaign, ISIS's ambitions were primarily based in their region. However, only after the U.S.-led airstrikes began, did we see ISIS starting to target Western nations. So what we can see is that by increasing the amount of intervention that the U.S. has within this region, increasing our presence there, we are only endangering the lives not only of those within the region, but we are also endangering the lives of Americans domestically as well. And it is for these reasons that I can only ask for your strongest affirmative vote or negative vote in today's debate. Thank you.
Here is the evidence about ground troops. And we can provide you with additional evidence if you'd like to see it.
Today's debate comes down to what is in the best interest of the United States and how American ground combat troops achieve this. we'll take a look at the best interest of the United States, and that's one of national security. ISIS right now is a direct threat to our national security. ISIS has published a hit list with the names and the addresses of over 300 U.S. government officials. Along with this, has led to other terrorist attacks such as that to bomb the Capitol. And specifically, according to NBC News from yesterday, a 20-year-old Kansas man was arrested this yesterday morning after federal authorities stated that they tried to plotted to detonate a car bomb at the Fort Riley military base in the name of ISIS. He also enlisted in the army so he could kill more fellow soldiers. So what you can see here is that there's a direct national security threat that is taking place at the moment. Furthermore, ISIS's growth is an even bigger threat to our national security. According to CBS News from June of last year, the bigger danger is that in the United States is not exactly what the group will look like once it evolves. While ISIS might not launch an attack against the United States until tomorrow, the brave threat here is that you have the seeds of a new terrorist movement emerging very aggressively. Over a decade ago, judges, Al-Qaeda was committing the same levels of threats ISIS is doing now, but it was until after the tragedy of 9/11 that we actually sent in more combat troops. Now, my opponents also stated that Iraq and Afghanistan wars have not been successful. However, since we went into these areas, there have been no successful domestic terror attacks in this region, specifically by Al-Qaeda. And furthermore, we're not going in the region through the same way. Instead of primarily being on boots on the ground, such as we have in previous wars, we're going to send in special forces. We're advocating to really send in forces to gain intelligence and to really work with local troops. So what you can see here is that ISIS is a direct threat to national security, and only ground combat troops can best achieve this. Now, this is because the status quo is not enough. There's a severe intelligence gap that is catching up with the effectiveness of U.S. airstrikes. Furthermore, regional fighters are not enough to stop ISIS. According to CNN from February of this year, ISIS fighters are gaining land in Syria and Baghdad, spurring leaders of that region to urgently plead for U.S. ground combat troops to help ISIS and extremist groups' actions. Now, although my opponents stated that ISIS has lost ground, specifically in Iraq, you can see that just because you lose ground in one country, ISIS is still gaining ground in other countries. ISIS still makes $3 million a day, and we cannot cut its resources simply by sending in air campaigns. We need to really stop them at the source, and we can only do this and really address the issue of national security by affirmative resolution. Thank you.
So you're stating that by using United States Special Forces that this would be enough to combat ISIS, is that correct?
We're saying that as of now, regional forces are unable to combat ISIS on its own, so sending in ground combat troops to work with ISIS and to work with these regional forces is going to make them a lot more capable and a lot more effective.
Do we have any reason to believe that these special forces would work, such as a past example of them being effective?
Well, as we stated multiple times, after U.S. intervention in Iraq specifically, we've been able to degrade Al-Qaeda to the point where there are no longer a threat to the U.S. soil and to U.S. national
security. But didn't you just state in your last speech that we didn't use special forces?
Forces in conjunction with the ground offense. We can see actually that we will have a similar type of mission, but it won't require the ground offense, only the special forces component.
Okay,
and so my question, actually, I believe it's our question.
All right.
Okay, so you keep stating, do you have any evidence that U.S. intervention through use of special forces specifically will lead to the growth of additional terrorist organizations? U.S. special forces specifically.
Well, we can see here that, as we said before, the occupation of the Middle East is what fueled ISIL. And
okay, so are we going to occupy the Middle East while fighting ISIS? Is that what you're saying?
Well, committing United States ground combat troops does lead to that.
So you're saying that if you send in a couple thousand ground combat troops, this is going to be...
Okay, well, in your evidence, it states themselves that the White House seems to be accepting this, but it is far from clear in what numbers to perform what tasks, for what duration,
okay,
and
well,
at what cost.
Okay, would you like to see evidence of what duration and what cost, because we have that if you
all right, sure. That would be better.
What are these specific numbers, actually?
Well, my partner will provide that. All right, so then...
Actually, can we ask you...
I believe we asked the last question. So you talked about Al-Qaeda and how we were able to limit Al-Qaeda's influence now. But how come we have been seeing ISIL as well? If we stop one terrorist organization, how is another being allowed to come up again?
Well, actually, I believe we can see... we can show you evidence from the American Free Enterprise Institute, published, I believe, March of this year, that states specifically ISIS actually originated more so over out of conflict in Syria, and it spilled into Iraq due to inadequate local forces.
Maybe ask you a question?
Sure.
So you said that United States airstrikes have led to more ISIS retaliation, correct?
Yes.
So why did the United States send airstrikes in the first place? Wasn't it to really to protect their national security?
Our case says that it is already demonstrating that American intervention has led to an increase in violence. So if we continue this intervention, we can only see these numbers increase.
Wasn't it just that we're already committed to defeating ISIS as we're leading the air coalition against this nation?
Actually,
this
I don't believe so. I believe President Obama said the mission of using these airstrikes was to degrade ISIS.
Right, to degrade and ultimately destroy ISIS is his direct quote.
Okay.
Okay, so it also says that there's no American military solution to the larger crisis in Iraq.
Okay, but would you agree that military operations would be a key component, not necessarily the only component?
We are conducting military operations there.
Okay, but these have not been sufficient, right, to stop the spread of ISIS in the Middle East.
So why should the United States bear the brunt of this responsibility then?
Because the reality is there are no other actors willing to act. The reality is there are no other local forces that are capable of acting. They have not proven themselves to be competent in stopping the spread of ISIS.
We're already committed to sending drones. I'm sure.
Time.
Judges, my final speech today, I'd like to evaluate the short term versus the long term. Now, my opponent suggests that United States ground combat troops will lead to an ultimate defeat of ISIL. But the fact of the matter is, ISIL gained power because of how weak the Middle East was due to the civil conflict, and terrorist organizations thrive in areas of civil conflict. Now, the civil conflict was exacerbated when the United States went to Iraq, went to the Middle East, and fought, and had this United States occupation. And once the United States pulled out, we only simply left matters even worse. Now, having the United States go in against the wishes of leaders such as the King of Jordan is only going to allow the United States to make more enemies than when it started with. Now, this is not going to be serving in the best interests of the United States. You can see here that committing the United States ground combat troops may defeat a short term, or what may result in a short term benefit of eliminating one terrorist organization, but we can see here that ISIL is thriving off of civil conflict. ISIL is going to be fueled by its ideology. Now, there are always going to be other terrorist organizations that have ideologies, extreme ideologies, that do not agree with the United States' own. The United States cannot be expected to fight every war that is presented on its doorstep. It is not the obligation of the United States to go back into another long drawn out war and commit more United States ground troops and lead to an increase in conflict and simply and only result in another short term solution. We have to address the matter in a long term viewpoint. Now, taking an alternate method by addressing the issue at the source, by repairing the Middle East and eliminating the civil conflict, we can help stop and eliminate another group like ISIL from coming up again. So we have to address this with an alternate method. As I said before previously in my speeches, we cannot keep addressing the situation with the same method and expect a different outcome. It simply does not work that way. Now, as Obama stated himself, quote, "There is no American military solution to the larger crisis in Iraq. The only lasting solution is reconciliation among Iraqi communities and stronger Iraqi security forces," end quote. So we can see here that the United States military ground combat ships is not going to be solving this problem. If anything, it is going to be making matters worse. And therefore, since the ISIL does not pose any existential threat to the United States, and doing and committing ships will not be serving in the best interest of the United States, I can only ask for Sean's negative vote in today's debate. Thank you.
I will take the remainder. I also would like to provide a cost-benefit analysis to whether sending in U.S. ground combat troops will have a net benefit to U.S. security. First, we have to look at the cost proposed by my opponents, specifically that ISIS is not a threat and the U.S. intervention will increase the conflict, and specifically the cost of increasing sectarian conflict. First, I'd like to point out the affirmative team has provided and read evidence the United States has the diplomatic leverage, it does have the logistical force needed to really remedy sectarian violence by specifically bringing Sunni and Shiite forces together under one coalition, again alleviating the threat of sectarian violence. Additionally, as regards to the threat that sending in U.S. troops will increase conflict, what my opponents are blatantly ignoring is the fact that the U.S. is already a target, the fact that the U.S. is already leading a military campaign against ISIS. ISIS is already targeting America, as we've seen through the capture and murder of several American hostages. As we can see that through the fact that ISIS has blatantly called for attacks on U.S. soil. The reality is you can't take away the fact that the U.S. has already attacked ISIS. You can't take away the fact that the United States is already an enemy of ISIS. We can see that actually, if we want to really remedy the threat to American security, we have to send in forces. The reality is, my opponents have provided no evidence that any alternatives will work. The reality is, terrorist organizations will not diplomatically compromise with the United States. What we're doing simply isn't working in the status quo. As we've seen, ISIS is expanding. ISIS is growing foreign support base. ISIS is growing into the international world. And judges, this leads us to the benefits of U.S. intervention, specifically that we provide the means for long-term stability, specifically by working with local troops in the field to boost their capability to defend themselves. Judges, this won't be another Afghanistan. We're not stating to occupy the Middle East. We're not stating to send in large amounts of ground troops. We're stating that you need small amounts of ground troops to really lead local forces in the field, to really provide them the means to ensure their own security in the long term. Judges, yes, the reality is there will always be terrorist groups, but this is not a reason to justify the U.S. not combating one of the most severe threats to U.S. security. We can see that really historically, we can see historically that the U.S. has been successful at mitigating the threat of terrorist organizations, specifically by mitigating Al-Qaeda. The reality is, if we intervene now, we can stop ISIS before it grows to the threat level that Al-Qaeda was in 2001. So it is really because U.S. ground troops provide the means to really have national security in the long term. I ask for your strongest affirmative vote in today's debate. Thank you.
Michael?
Yes.
And observers? Good Good afternoon, my name is Maya, and I'll be your first con speaker in today's debate. Resolve, committing U.S. ground combat troops to fight ISIL is in the best interest of the United States. In today's debate, the con team operates under the assumption of ISIL's exceptional and unique nature within their current role in the Middle East, as well as in defense of the status quo. Contention one, counterproductivity. Due to the structure of the U.S. counterterrorist protocol, our relationship with the Middle East, and many other factors, U.S. ground intervention would not be an effective way to counter ISIL. According to Audrey Cronin, putting more U.S. troops on the ground would be counterproductive, entangling the U.S. in an unwinnable war that could go on for decades. The U.S. cannot rebuild the Iraqi state or determine the outcome of the Syrian civil war. Frustrating as it might be for some, when it comes to military action, Washington should stick to the realistic course and recognizes the limitations of U.S. military as a long-term solution. The military tactics used to combat terrorist groups like Al-Qaeda will not work against ISIL due to different government structures, goals, and implemented strategies. In addition to this, quote, ISIS is now led by well-trained, capable former Iraqi military leaders who know U.S. techniques and habits because Washington helped train them. Fighting against ISIL on the ground proved to be ineffective due to increased predictability. Overall, our outdated counter-terrorist policies will not work with ISIL, especially when we consider putting boots on the ground. Contention 2, anti-U.S. sentiment. Already unpopular in the Middle East, the U.S. has no solid foundation on which to base any ground military operations. According to Cronin, after experiencing more than a decade of continuous war, the American public simply would not support the long-term occupation and intense fighting that would be required to obliterate ISIS. The pursuit of a full-fledged military campaign would exhaust U.S. resources and offer little hope of attaining the objective. Wars pursued at odds with political reality cannot be won. The U.S. does not have a history of successfully pulling out of wars once the goal has been achieved. In addition to this, if U.S. involvement with ISIL were to fail, the already copious amounts of anti-Americanism seen in the Middle East would logically increase, which America cannot afford. Lastly, according to the Washington Institute, any U.S. overtures either to Assad or Iran as potential partners against ISIS run a great risk both of further alienating the Egyptian and Saudi publics and of further inflating the dangerous sectarian polarization among Lebanese at the same time. With the world pushing for the U.S. to take a distant military and prominent diplomatic role, we must respond in an agreeable fashion. Contention 3, uniquely volatile situation. The rise of ISIL has created a Middle East more volatile and violent than we have seen in decades. More importantly, however, is the convoluted state of warfare within the status quo. The rise of ISIL has contributed greatly to an alliance between Iraq and Iran, specifically with weaponry, according to BBC News. However, the 22-country Arab League announced on March 30th their plan to create a force, quote, comprised of some 40,000 elite troops, warplanes, navy ships, and weapons, which could be used to combat terrorist groups like the Islamic State, according to Fox. This impending clash between the traditional U.S. allied Gulf states in the Arab League and U.S.'s ally Iraq puts the U.S. in the middle of two warring factions. Stationing U.S. ground troops could partner the U.S. with Iran, a country with which the U.S. does not want to get involved in, as well as turns against our traditional Gulf state allies. According to Friedman, the current doctrine requires a balance between Iran and Saudi Arabia, with the U.S. tilting back and forth. Under this doctrine, and in the military reality, the U.S. cannot afford full-scale engagement on the ground in Iraq. This progression in the Middle Eastern fight against ISIL is only the latest in a series of confusing diplomatic relations. The U.S. cannot afford to straddle two warring groups and must instead keep their ground combat troops at home. Thank you, and as for these reasons, I can probably ask for your strongest con ballot in today's debate. Okay, judges, ready? Good afternoon, judges. My name is Elisa, and today my partner and I will be upholding the resolution resolved. Committing United States ground combat troops to fight ISIL is in the best interest of the United States. We offer these definitions for further clarification. ISIL, otherwise known as ISIS, IS, or Daesh, is a predominantly Sunni jihadist group that seeks to sow civil unrest in Iraq and the Levant with the aim of establishing a caliphate, a single transnational Islamic state according to the Center on Foreign Relations.
Best interest is defined as the advantage or benefit of a person or group, according to Oxford dictionaries. We believe that it is in the best interest for the U.S. to send ground combat troops for the following two reasons. First, America must ensure its national security by sending ground combat troops, and second, current methods of combating ISIL have failed. Contention 1. America must ensure its national security by sending ground combat troops. Subpoint A, ISIL is building a terrorist state. An article from Stanford explains, what do the United States and its people have to fear from ISIS? Threats stand out. First is the fact that an extremely hostile organization with a long history of lethal attacks against the West, particularly the U.S., now has a territorial base from which to plan and organize terrorism against the U.S. and its allies, as well as to destabilize the rest of Iraq. As ISIS continues to make headway in their campaign to create a pan-Islamic caliphate, they have begun to recruit international fighters. As Boston Globe writes, some 22,000 foreign fighters from about 100 countries have gone to fight in Iraq and Syria. Intelligence and counterterrorism officials believe that at least 100 Americans are among the Western recruits. These foreign-trained terrorists are dangerous as they possess the documents needed to enter countries like the U.S. or other Western nations, and in turn could wreak havoc and destruction. Subpoint B. ISIL's attraction of foreign fighters threatens America. As mentioned before, ISIL's attempt to build a terrorist state threatens America's national security. Brookings Brief writes, between 1990 and 2010, approximately 11% of foreign fighters have become active security threats after returning home. Not a small number. Moreover, there is already a precedent for fighters with experience in Syria returning to their home countries. The cases of Mehdi Nimrouche in Brussels and Ibrahim Boudina in France suggest such fears are already being realized. To make things even worse, getting in and out of Syria, a major training area, has been easier than ever due to the ongoing civil war. Daniel Byman, a Georgetown professor, writes, far more people are going to Syria. It is far easier to travel to and back from Syria. So there is going to be a disapparat out of Syria at some point, and we must be determined not to let the lines be drawn from Syria today to a future 9/11. Contention 2. Current methods of combating ISIL have failed. As America debates whether to deploy ground combat troops existing in Iraq, existing Iraqi, Syrian, Iranian, and Kurdish forces battle ISIL. However, these troops aren't well-trained nor well-armed, and as such cannot contend with a well-oiled battle machine that is ISIL. Business Insider reports, Mosul was meant to have approximately 25,000 soldiers and police defending it. In actuality, there was at most 10,000 security personnel in the city at the time of the attack. Many were under-equipped or deployed in a way that left the city badly exposed. One of the main entries into Mosul that ISIS attacked had only 40 men guarding it. Not only does this highlight the failure of local forces, especially the U.S.-trained Iraqi forces guarding Mosul, but also their lack of supplies. Furthermore, American airstrikes on the region have failed to stop ISIL. They have been able to, quote, almost double command controls in Syria since the U.S.-led coalition began airstrikes against the extremist group in the summer. This extremist group has continued to expand despite more than 800 airstrikes. And it is for these reasons that I ask for your strongest affirmative vote in today's debate. Thank you.
Direct threats to the United States since we have taken back 25% of their territory, 75% of their revenue?
Well, actually, yes. They have actually threatened the U.S. that they would hope to see the ISIL flag flying above the
capital. What's the date on that threat exactly?
My partner will bring that up.
But do you have any recent threats that have happened since we have recaptured their land?
Well, for example, we can see that ISIL actually recently produced a list of ex-fighters and their information and asked for people in the U.S. who sympathized with them to
attack. Right, but can I have the date on that threat, please?
I will bring that to you.
Do you have a question for me?
Yes, I do. Would you agree that the hypothetical defeat of ISIS would help the U.S.?
You mean having their defeat? Yes, it would. Okay.
Well, since this is so important, if we can see that local forces are not going to do this, if not the U.S., then who?
Well, we're saying that this eventual defeat is not hypothetical because it's happening in the status quo, as we have taken back 25% of their land.
Can I see your opinions on this 25%?
Oh, definitely. And we've also taken back 75% of their revenue.
Okay.
All right, so question for you. If recruitment is such a big issue, why do we conquer this through your main means of recruitment, which is Twitter and YouTube, going through the more cyberspace
method? The reason why ISIL gets so much press is because it's so successful. People don't need to go on social media to find examples of ISIS. They can see that on the news. It is ISIL's success that actually makes them so appealing.
All right, so you see this on the news. How is putting in ground combat troops going to affect what the news broadcasters show?
Well, simply, it is going to show that the U.S. is able to handle this threat. We are taking divisive action.
So you're saying that the U.S. taking back 25% of the land is not them handling it correctly?
Excuse me? The U.S. taking 25% of the land?
Yes, due to U.S. airstrikes, 25% of the land has been taken.
Was that directly due to U.S. airstrikes?
Yes, directly due to U.S. airstrikes. Definitely.
You talked in your case about partnering with Iran, right?
Correct.
Are you aware that Iran is the biggest state sponsor of terrorism?
Yes, and we're saying that's why it's not a good idea to partner with Iran.
So should we let them influence the Iraqi politics, influence Iraq?
I think you're misunderstanding our third contention. If you'd like me to clarify for that,
yes,
I can. So we're saying that there is the Arab League, which consists of our Gulf state allies, Saudi Arabia, as 22-country league.
Okay.
And then we have Iraq and Iran on the other hand. And our Saudi allies have specifically asked us not to put U.S. ground troops in this region. My partner can bring up the evidence for that.
You know?
And so putting troops on the ground would essentially side us with Iraq and Iran. And
exactly.
You say to yourself, we do not want to partner with Iran.
No, we need to make sure that Iran doesn't grow its influence.
So you're saying it's okay for the U.S. to partner itself with Iran, who is the biggest
supporter
of terrorism?
No, we are trying to provide Iraq with the troops they need, with the supplies they need, and not let Iran bully them.
So you're saying that Iran and Iraq are not working together?
They are working together, but if U.S. is to step in, we could be the main actor.
Do you have evidence stating that we can solve Iran's terrorist issue?
Yes, we do.
Can I see that, please?
Yes, you may.
All right, so, yes, I do. Going back to what we were just talking about, so you're saying it's okay for the U.S. to choose between their two allies on either side, the Arab League and the Iran-Iraq conflict?
Well, it's entirely necessary to defeat ISIS, which we have established as a
So it's necessary to alienate them.
I believe that we're out of time.
Thank you.
I'd like to take 30 seconds of
Here's the 25%.
Judges ready? Time for ready. Opponents ready?
Yes.
And partner ready. Hello, my name is Michael, and I will be the second negative speaker in today's debate. I'd like to begin by responding to my opponent's contentions, then moving on to support my own. So my opponent's first contention, they talk about American national security being the highest priority simply because, as I mentioned in our subpoint A, that ISIL is forming a terrorist state. Now, they presented no evidence of a credible existential threat to the United States homeland. Therefore, we cannot accept this as a valid threat to national security. Furthermore, in their subpoint B, they state that the attraction of foreign fighters is the greatest reason that the Islamic State remains strong. However, they state that the success of ISIL inspires recruitment. So if this is the case, then the current failure that my opponents brought up, that my partner brought up, in the most recent crossfire should serve to slow ISIL's recruitment. And if that is not the case, and it is in fact due to their digital presence, then a means such as cyber warfare could be used to limit this recruitment. Either way, boots on the ground are not necessary for the United States. Furthermore, their second contention, they state that there is a current failure regarding the U.S. approach and the larger approach throughout the region. And what my partner and I are stating is that there's no element of failure in the status quo. I'd like to bring up some evidence to support this from ABC News, March 13, 2015, that the forces in the region have recaptured 25% of the land held by the Islamic State. Furthermore, according to The Economist, March 21st, 2015, 75% of ISIL's revenues have been cut due to U.S. airstrikes on their oil facilities. So this shows a substantial weakening of ISIS, especially since the 25% was over a course of 2 months. So what this shows is a rapid defeat in the status quo without United States ground combat troops. So the explanation for this is simple, and that is because the Islamic State is a conventional fighting force. I have evidence here from Audrey Cronin from Foreign Affairs, March 2015, stating, if ISIS is purely and simply anything, it is a pseudo-state led by a conventional army, and that is why the counterterrorism and counterinsurgency strategies that greatly diminish the threat from al-Qaeda will not work against ISIS. And coupled with this data is the fact that ISIL is simply outnumbered as an army, the Kurdish Peshmerga numbering at around 190 fighters, and the Iraqi army numbering at around 250,000 fighters, just simply outnumber the ISIL forces of 30,000 fighters. So that's the reason why they're being defeated, because they are a conventional army. Now, my opponents mentioned Mosul specifically, and I have this evidence here from Jeremy Bender of Business Insider, July 8th, 2014, stating, when ISIS overran Mosul, they captured weaponry that allowed them a conventional army rather than a ragtag insurgency. So as I just mentioned, their shift to a conventional army, this battle specifically that my opponents mentioned represents a paradigm shift for the entirety of the Islamic State. So that's why, unless they can bring up any other example other than that, we see a continuous success with the forces on the ground. Moving on, they express concern about Iran. And what my partner and I are saying with regards to Iran is that we cannot fight alongside them, because if we implement ground troops, we would be entering the region and fighting alongside the Iranian-backed militias. Furthermore, I have some evidence here from Newsmax, March 1st, 2015, from a quote from King Abdullah saying that it's not the Western fight and he does not want to see American boots on the ground as part of the battles. There's a long-term element to this, which is obviously the ideological one. That's the one more complicated, more difficult. Trying to keep Western boots off the ground is, I think, an essential part of how we move forward. I think this is why most of us are looking at it that way. End quote. So this shows a direct request from the foreign powers in the region to not send in U.S. ground troops, simply because the U.S. has no place in this ideological battle. So furthermore, we're risking our allies. Although my opponents seem to think that it's necessary for us to alienate our allies, the negative team maintains that those are our greatest interests in the region, and protecting those would greatest serve the United States. For these reasons, and the reasons we mentioned in our case, I urge your negative vote in today's debate.
Good afternoon, judges. I'll be your second affirmative speaker in today's debate. I'd like to first go over my opponent's case, and if time permits, I'd like to reaffirm my own. In my opponent's first contention, they talked about how essentially we won't want to intervene because we're not that effective in fighting ISIS. And specifically, it's because ISIS is a conventional army. But I'd like to point out that America's army is built to fight conventional warfare. We are not built and trained to fight guerrilla warfare. That was only specifically for special forces in Iraq in the intervention. However, what we have to understand is that most of America's army is built to not only fight conventional armies, but to succeed against them. That's the whole reason we have an army, to fight against other states. Essentially, what ISIS is another state, has another army. We see this is exactly why American forces will be strong, and thus we see that that point concedes to us. Furthermore, they talked about how Kurd militias can be used instead of American forces. But what's important to point out is that current forces in other places such as Libya, Yemen, and Syria have all failed to stop the advancement of ISIL. For example, according to the International Business Times, dated March 20th of this year, it states that ISIS recently seized control of at least two cities along Libya's Mediterranean coast after taking territory in ISIS, Syria and Iraq last year. The militants will head the illegal migrants to Europe, with corruption and destruction will spread just like in Libya, but it will be harder to confront them. What that points out to us is that because ISIS has been able to successfully take land, especially in important places, especially port cities, they can now have openings to other places such as America and Europe. This is important to understand because it is a direct threat against us. Like my opponents have been consistently saying that there is no threat. A terrorist state is not a threat. But we have to understand that the terrorist state is the most important threat against us. It's the most important threat against us, and the main reason being, because according to the Independent, if ISIS is succeeded in firmly consolidating their grip on land that they occupy in Syria and Iraq, we will see the world's first truly terrorist state established within a few hours flying time from our country. This only points out that America has something to worry about, because ISIS can send soldiers there from themselves to America in only several hours. This is important to point out because this is a huge threat against ISIS. ISIS has already made threats and attacks in several countries, including Belgium. For example, in Belgium, CNN points out that In Belgium, the suspected Islamist terrorist who had a shootout with police on Thursday in Bavaria's Belgium have ties to ISIS, linked terror cells in other European countries. The two suspects who died in the shootout are believed to have fought with ISIS in Syria. ISIS has already shown their ability to already gain access to other Western countries, and America could be next. We cannot wait for the situation to get worse. We're already seeing on the ground that if we let the militias fight now, the problem will only get worse in the future. Furthermore, moving further, we have to understand that America must intervene. What other people want, like my opponents are saying, that other countries are saying we shouldn't intervene. This, what other people want are not necessarily what is in the best interest of America. We have to understand, we have to look back at today's resolutions, that we're trying to do what's best interest of America, that is protecting our national security. And listening to others dictate our own national security, what we do to protect our citizens, is not in the best interest of America. Therefore, that point falls. Also, they talked about how the Arab League is making an alliance to combat ISIL, but they failed to point at specific successes of the Arab League. First of all, we don't even know if they're actually working or doing anything to help stop ISIS. We have only seen Iraq and Iran trying to intervene and stop ISIS. Which brings me to my next point, that allowing Iran to influence Iraq is not in our best interest. Like what my partner has pointed out beforehand, allowing Iran to wield influence is not a good thing. Like she said, Iran is the biggest state sponsor of terrorism, and as a result of that, what we have seen there is that we have seen many of Iran's success also destroying Iraq. For example, the U.S. News and Report states that further meddling by Iran could break Iraq along sectarian lines, creating fissures that could be mended and solidifying power among the Shiite allies of Iran, strengthening the influence of the Islamic Republic in the region, and supplanting America's patronage. This is not what we want. We need to stop ISIS, and the only way we can do so is through American forces. And it's for these reasons that I ask for your strongest affirmative vote in today's debate. Thank you.
Troops not be fighting alongside Iran in Iraq?
Not necessarily. What we can do is we can supplant Iraq's reliance on Iran by using our own forces instead of Iran, the time when Iraq relies on them. Like we said before, we don't really want Iran fighting specifically because it's only destroying Iraq and only because Iran is the biggest state sponsor of terrorism. We're trying to get rid of terrorism by allowing Iran to reign free in the region. They're also addressing their own agenda of increasing terrorism. May I ask you a question?
Of course.
So when you talk about the Arab League and how it's coming together, do you have evidence that states that the Arab League has had success?
No, we state the only evidence we bring up regarding the Arab League is that it is forming these forces. The successes we've seen are from mostly the Iraqis.
So how long will it take
Iraqis.
To form? It seems to take a long time.
So my partner can bring that up in her next speech. Okay, I have another question for you.
Yes.
So you mentioned Libya and Yemen as parts of the territories under ISIL's control. Are you explicitly stating that the caliphate extends into these nations?
Well, if ISIS has taken land there, yes, it does. It's not specifically set to several regions. ISIS will expand as much as it wants and as much as it needs. And we see that by allowing only stopping it in certain places, we're not really combating ISIS. On a whole, ISIS has taken more land than it has lost. In Syria, where most of the training goes on, we have seen that ISIS has continued to take land and start to train their soldiers there. May I ask a question?
Yes.
So you talked about how ISIS captured U.S. weapons, correct?
Not necessarily. Exactly what is this in reference to?
You said in your last speech that because ISIS captured U.S. weapons that they're becoming a more conventional force.
In my last speech? Oh! No, as they overran Mosul, they gained the equipment that allowed them to become a more conventional fighting force. They were much more like a simple terrorist insurgency before they overran Mosul.
So if they now have these now you're saying that essentially these Iraqi forces can't defend themselves and can't defend their own country, correct?
No, we're saying that they're all the more capable.
The Iraqi forces are more capable of
defending
themselves after losing Mosul and losing their weapons to ISIS. You're saying they're more capable?
No, we're saying they are more capable because they have taken back 25% of the land. After the ISIL seizure of Mosul and they become a conventional fighting force, they're now outnumbered and they must fight like a conventional fighting force, which has led to their loss of 25% of their territory.
Do you know how many soldiers of Islamic State soldiers took ISIL compared to the Iraqi forces that were there?
You mentioned it in your first contention.
Yes, so 2,000 Islamic State soldiers took Mosul compared to 10,000 there. So even if they have numbers, does that necessarily mean that they're going to be effective against stopping a better fighting force?
Well, I did address this in my response to your contention because I stated that Mosul was a paradigm shift for the Islamic State as their fighting style changed, exactly.
So wouldn't that fighting style suit American armies, since American armies are trained to fight against other states and against other conventional
There's
armies?
There's no question about how good the United States is fighting. Is it fighting as an army? What the question is that there's simply too much to risk.
So you're saying that they are going to be effective because you have no questions that they would, is what you're saying,
We're
right?
saying that they're not effective because they have too much to lose.
Okay, I believe. All
right, thank you.
Now, 4 months into 2015, we have seen no direct threats to the U.S. coming from that region. And on the issue of the Mosul attack, that is when the tides changed with ISIL. And since then is when we have been seeing all this success due to airstrikes. Moving on to the issue of our diplomatic relations, we agree that Iran isn't someone who we want to partner with, which is exactly why we should not put our troops on the ground. Really simply, it's a catch-22 situation. If we were to go against the wishes of our allies in the Arab League with Saudi Arabia, who provides 8% of American oil, we would be alienating those allies to side with Iran and Iraq, thereby partnering ourselves with Iran, and that is not something that we can afford. And the Arab League, on the issue of their success, first off, they announced their plan to build this army just 11 days ago. We can't expect that army to be fully functional within its time period of 11 days. The main issue we're arguing here is our diplomatic relationships. And on that note, we don't want to partner with Iran for other reasons in addition to our relationships with them. We cannot afford to alienate our ally with Israel. We cannot risk thousands of lives for hypothetical idea. We need to stick with what we know and what is currently working in the status quo for the betterment of a U.S. tomorrow. Thank you, and with that, we will humbly ask for strongest calm ballot for today.
Why this exactly supports the affirmative side of today's debate. Now, we need to look at this in terms of ISIS is a threat right now and ISIS is a threat in the future. Currently, they are radicalizing people at home and abroad and training foreign fighters who could come back to their home countries and commit attacks. We have already seen attacks in France and Belgium from these foreign fighters. Furthermore, we can see several attempted attacks in the U.S. However, they were stopped, but we have to ask ourselves, how long will it be till one of these threats comes through? ISIL has actually called for direct attacks on U.S. soil from sympathizers, so we can see that ISIS is a threat right now. Furthermore, in the future, if they are able to grow, they are, as we recall, a terrorist state. What they will become is a safe haven for terrorism, a place where people can come to radicalize themselves. Furthermore, what if they come across an air force? If they are to expand and grow, we can see an even bigger threat in the future than we have already. Now let's look at why U.S. ground troops and only U.S. ground troops will run me. Once again, I'd like to cite my opponent's evidence, and they talk about how it only lost 25% of territory it once held in Iraq. Now we have to understand that ISIS operates in Syria. It operates in Yemen. There are many places where ISIS currently operates. So we have to understand that just because they've won in Iraq, they're gaining elsewhere. Furthermore, in their very own article, it comments that this assessment of the amount of land was not an exact science. Okay, we also need to look at how to help our allies. But I must once again ask our opponents, is keeping up with diplomacy rated above our own national security? Furthermore, we're talking about Iran. As we have mentioned before, Iran is creating a great influence on Iraq. Is this something we want, the greatest state sponsor of terrorism doing this? So our opponents talk of nipping the threat in the bud. Yes, that is what we need. In order to combat ISIS decisively, we need to send in U.S. ground troops, and it is for this reason that I can only ask for your strongest affirmative vote in today's debate. Thank you.
We've established that the Islamic State controls 35% of Syrian territory, so how could we possibly commit ground troops without, in the eyes of our allies, siding with either the Assad regime or extreme Syrian rebels?
Because you see that the Syrian rebels that we currently support are moderates. We don't support either the Assad or the extreme rebels. You fail to realize that in Syria there are moderate rebels. That's the people who we're going to support, not the Assad regime and not the extreme rebels that you keep on talking
about. So you're saying that Assad does not want ISIL to go away?
Yes, he does want ISIL to go away, but the thing is we're not allying with him. You have to understand that
how
our
allies
are
we not allying with him?
We're allying with, as my partner said, moderate rebels, not Assad and not extremists.
So what we're asking is, in the eyes of our allies, as far as we're concerned, you can say we'll ally with whoever we are, but the way that our allies view it, how can we ensure that they won't view that as a traitor to
our Arab
League
alliance? Do you
think that
the view of ourselves in our allies' eyes is more important than our own national security?
Well, we're saying that we have, and I also ask for evidence on this.
You believe that it's more important?
I'm answering your question right now. I ask for evidence on this, and you have yet to provide me with it, but we have seen no direct threat since we've recaptured land directly towards the U.S. from ISIL, correct?
So
you said you have that evidence, and I've yet to see it.
So how is ISIS not building a terrorist state a direct threat to America? Like we read before, they only keep hours flying time away from America, and they've already captured two port cities in Libya. So how is that not a direct threat to America?
Well, you said that by getting these port cities in Libya, we would see a direct threat. However, have we seen that come into fruition?
Yes, we have seen it. We've seen it. There's threat. The reason why that we have...
May I please see that evidence?
We've actually seen people from ISIS. ISIS members actually go into...
But was that before or after we reconquered their territory?
I believe that was...
With the Libya one or the...
May I please see the evidence so I can see the dates?
Okay. Yes.
All right, so do you have a question for us? Or maybe move on to ask another one.
Okay, so once again, we have to ask, if not the U.S., then who? You have supplied us with no other actors besides these regional ones. And as we have established, they are actually... only gaining a little bit of land compared to what ISIS is doing.
Well, if you'd like alternatives, we could present those. But our main argument is that the forces in the region are working. We have seen immense success.
That these militias actually slaughter and massacre people after they do conflicts.
Did you just say we're supporting modern militias?
No, these are not the militias we're supporting.
This is the Iranian militias that we read before.
Right,
only
so
increased
you're
terrorism
saying
and violence within Iraq. And so that's not exactly what we really want in that.
And that's exactly what my partner and I are arguing. We're saying that it's a bad thing to put ourselves in relationships with Iran,
end by putting
but
U.S. troops on ground when we are doing
our,
that.
We're not saying we're putting ourselves in a relationship, but you fail to understand about the argument is that we're trying to replace Iran as Iraq's reliable
So are you saying that Iraq would simply disregard Iran as soon as the U.S. steps in?
Yes, because
can I see your evidence
for
that,
Iraq, yes, I mean, America is the one that they asked for help first, but because Iran got there first and because America failed to take any action, that this is the reason why you have essentially
May
why
I
Iran...
May I see that evidence,
yes,
but I see our time.
I'll take your number of application.
Sorry, can we just get a list of the evidence? Yeah, so the recent threats that were post-reconquering their territory, the U.S., Iraq would drop Iran as soon as we come in, and that it's necessary to choose between our allies. I asked for that in our first crossfire, and also U.S. involvement would soothe our relations with Iran, which I also asked for in our first crossfire. You stated that that U.S. coming in would help soothe our relations with Iran and make them more moderate. I asked for that in our first crossfire.
I don't believe that's what you said.
Basically, America was replaced by Iran.
Oh, okay,
America.
Thank you.
Last speech for the negative team in today's debate. I'd really like to return to our case and affirm the negative perspective. So we stress the greater Middle Eastern environment as well as talking about specifically U.S. interests. Now my opponents simplify U.S. efficiency in the region to how good we are at fighting as an army. Now a more mature analysis of the situation is a cost-benefit analysis, and that's what I'd like to run through today. Now, the Islamic State will be defeated with or without the United States ground troops. That you can be assured of. The forces in the region accompanied with U.S. airstrikes have already taken back 25% of the land and cut ISIS revenues by 75%. So this is a substantial and swift defeat of the Islamic State. So the caliphate will be seized and ISIS will be defeated. Now, my opponents think that because of terrorist attacks, the main reason for the United States to get involved is because of the ostensible threat to homeland security. Now, this is their main cost to not being involved. However, the evidence that they provided us are all from the occasion of before we have taken back 25% of their land in the past 2 months. So therefore, this is not a substantial or even credible threat anymore against the United States. Furthermore, in their own evidence concerning Iran, it states, quote, Iran seeks not to complement U.S. efforts to advance regional stability, but to project its own hegemonic ambitions. And then down below, it states, quote, unfortunately, the Obama administration has failed to recognize that U.S. and Iranian interests do not align. So what we're seeing here in regards to Iran is that specifically, that our interest with Iran, they're saying that we will supplant Iranian influence, but this is not the case. The United States will be forced to fight alongside, and that is not in the best interest of our allies. And this is the main cost that the negative team presents, that we will be losing our allies no matter what if we put in ground troops. We will lose somebody, and that's the main interest that we have to look out for. And for these reasons, I urge your negative vote in today's debate. Thank you.
May I take your meeting a minute, please?
Thank you very much.
Thank you. In my final speech today, judges, I'd like to give a cost-benefit analysis of today's debate. And what this debate, the cost of my opponents have put forward is essentially that there's a paradigm shift in the war, that ISIS is trying to fight a more conventional type of war. Second, they also talk about how America would lose allies because we're intervening in the region. And last, they talk about how militias will be successful, that allying ourselves with Iran will not be in our best interest. And to talk about the first point, we have to understand that all of these points flow to the affirmative side. Specifically, for the first point, they talk about how they lose allies. And the whole the first point, they talk about how essentially America, that there's a changing paradigm shift in the war and it's conventional warfare. But again, I'd like to keep on pointing out that America's troops, America's army, is built to fight a conventional state, a conventional army. And this is where we succeed at. We're not good at fighting world warfare because that's not what our army is for. Our army is to build and to fight conventional states, something that ISIS is. And we see that with those affirmative side. Furthermore, they talk about losing allies. And in this problem, we have to understand that essentially we won't lose any allies, specifically because essentially Saudi Arabia and every other Arab nation in that area views align with America. They want essentially to take out ISIS. And even if they don't want America to, we have to understand that America has to take them out. My opponents, my evidence about the Arab League still have not shown any evidence that they will be successful, that they have been successful. Furthermore, I'd like to point out that it's also important to understand that we need to prioritize our national security over what other people want us to do. It's more important to protect our citizens. Finally, when they talked about how we'll ally with Iran, what's important to understand about that is that we're not saying that we should ally ourselves with Iran. We're saying that we're trying to replace Iraqi's reliance upon Iran. And the evidence that they read essentially points that out, that because we have failed to intervene in that war and that conflict, that they're relying upon Iran and the biggest state sponsor of terrorism. We cannot let this happen. We must go in there. We must stop Iran's influence. Furthermore, we also see that the cost of stopping this will be stopping a terrorist state. As I read evidence beforehand, which my opponents have not done anything against, we have seen that ISIS has provided a huge threat, specifically in the event that they can and there are only a few flying hours away, and they have taken several port cities. And it's for these reasons that I ask for your strongest affirmative vote in today's debate. Thank you.